And last week we spoke about our conversion to Orthodoxy. And the real core premise was we came from the Western Christian world, where every time somebody has a different interpretation of Scripture, a new schism is born and a new group breaks off, and or they think, well, we need to go do something different, and then another schism. And to date, there are about, I believe it's 38,000 schisms and breaks that have happened since Martin Luther and the Reformation. And all of them claiming, no, ours is the right interpretation of Scripture. And so we had come across in historical studies of how we got our Bible, this concept from St. Irenaeus that said, if you go to all the churches that were founded by the apostles, whatever they're all saying that's the same as each other. Now, mind you, we're talking about, you know, on up from Jerusalem, up through Syria, all of Asia Minor, through Greece, Italy, as far as Spain, all of North Africa. I mean, the churches are spread at this point, and each one is operating independently. And so the basic idea is, if they're all saying the same thing as each other, then that either came from the apostles, or they all threw out what the apostles gave them and replaced it with the exact same thing as each other, and there was never an argument, never a schism, never a council, because we have all these records of all these battles that the church had over various concepts and how to define them. But here we would have, if it weren't from the apostles what they all held the same, then we would have to have some picture in our minds of major shifts happening and changes, and nobody disagreed. So this was basically the premise that we set forth in order to move forward and say, okay, whatever we find when we look historically that's early and universal in all the churches, that had to come from the apostles, and we're going to conform to it. And one of the things that I really want to convey is, I think more than anything else, is that setting up a system of thought that protects us from ourselves. Because when you talk to people, generally what they believe and will tell you they believe, if you start asking why are you in this church? Why are you in that faith? Generally, you'll hear people saying something like, all these things that resonate with them and they like about it. But as I was saying last week, if that's the basis of what is true in your mind, oh, I hear that, I like that, and therefore I'm going to affirm it as true, essentially you're going to construct a God that looks just like you do. And you're going to be worshiping in front of a mirror. And this is really what I want to get across, that there has to be, I've heard, you know, there have been, in the past 6 years that we've been around the Coptic Church, and I think almost five that since we've been baptized, we hear various questions come up recently about, you know, things back in Egypt and the Pope speaking, and people here not wanting to agree with him and wanting to do something in opposition or whatever. But it's always, when I hear these, it's always based upon this, well, I think this for this reason, and I think that for that reason. And nobody's going back to those who went before them and saying, what can we draw from them to apply to this situation? We act as though we're the first person to hear from God. We're the first person to think clearly. Well, if Christ dwells in the church, then he has done so for 2,000 years. There's a voice that we need to turn back and start listening to. And whenever questions come up, we need to go back and say, what does that voice say? We can't be elevating ourselves up to this place where we're standing as judge over the church. And I've encountered, I've encountered some people who basically came into the Orthodox Church in saying, yes, I love the church, and saying all the things they love about the church. And to be honest, that's, in my mind, that's still not a conversion yet. That just means that the church met your standard. But even if the church meets your standard, you're still standing as the judge looking down upon the church, and she measured up, so I'll join. Well, that's not conversion in my mind. In my mind, historically, conversion is when you are clinging to the ankles of the church, saying, save me. When every time you approach a question with the church, your attitude is, if we are in disagreement, I'm probably the one that's wrong, and I need to conform to what the historical church has said. Now, that's not to say the current Coptic church this year, necessarily. Maybe, maybe not. The question is, the church isn't the Coptic church. The church is all of the churches that were established by the apostles that have been going on now for 2,000 years. That's the church. There may be something we find where we are a little off from, say, the history of the church. I'm not saying there is, I'm saying it's possible. If so, we still have to look for the historical church and what she says. But generally speaking, yeah, what we hear and what the church says today is pretty much what was handed down. You guys know that things don't get tossed about loosely or changed easily within the church. So to be orthodox, in my mind, is to understand that the church carries the cumulative wisdom and knowledge of 2,000 years, and it's for me to receive from her the life that I need. And us coming in from the outside, this is kind of how it impacted us. We talk about very often, there was an article I wrote for St. John magazine called An American Viewpoint of an Egyptian Mother. And I'm drawing an analogy saying that somebody who grows up in an Egyptian home, if you hear them talk about their mom, they might say, she's bossy, she's controlling, she's in all my business, she wants to dominate everything. And this is kind of okay. But now imagine somebody gets adopted into that household. See, us, we had what Anastasia calls girlfriends. In the world where we were, a church is like a girlfriend. And you have a disagreement, you go down the street to another one, and you're done. Here, the church is your mother. As St. Cyprian said, you can't have God as your father without the church as your mother. So now imagine us coming from this world where we were orphans because we didn't have a mother. And we come into this Egyptian household. And you might be saying, mom is controlling, she's bossy, she's in your business. We're looking at it going, mom really loves you. That's why she wants to know everything. She feeds you and she tends to your wounds and she gives you the wisdom that all of her family has collected for all these centuries. And so we're going to have a different viewpoint, and what we hope to convey to people is a different set of eyes to look at mom and kind of see what she would look like to somebody who didn't have a mom for a long time.
Okay, so last week we brought up some of our struggles that we had. We talked about iconography, walking into the church and seeing people, what we thought was worshiping these pictures and kissing them, and kind of freaked us out a little bit. We talked about how much of a challenge it was to know about confession, because we were like, there's one mediator between God and man, that is Christ Jesus alone, that was putting another human in between. We talked about what Deuteronomy calls necromancy, about talking to dead people and asking for their help, and that's intercession of the saints. And so there were some of the things that we like kind of just threw out there and left hanging for the sake of time, never really resolved them. So I'm just curious, like, any of you that heard the talk and have any questions, maybe how we got unstuck from some of those, or if you had other questions, please feel free to ask.
Yeah, I think on this specific question, but generally how you overcame.
Go ahead. I guess the question would be how you overcame it. Maybe you can give us some ideas about how we could talk to others as well about the iconography issue. Yeah.
Specifically for me with the iconography issue, to again lay the foundation, is in the Protestant churches that we came from, it wasn't just this is a different way that people worship, or that there was an appreciation in the churches that I attended that were Protestant for cultural differences. Iconography and the prayer, the intercession of the saints that happens through the iconography was specifically taught against, as it is a sin against God. That it's idolatry, that you shall make for yourself no graven images. A bunch of Bible verses would be applied to it. So it wasn't just something like, oh, that's weird. It was, that's terrifying for us. So there's the foundation of it. And so how do we get past that? It was pretty hard for me at first. Tilo has his own experience. But I would have to say that it was something that I didn't have an aha moment on, that I'm like, oh, I suddenly get it. Because I started to learn more and more of how these are windows, and Tilo can unpack that more. It seeped in slowly, but I think the biggest turning point for me was a conversation I was having with my friend who's a Russian priest. And I said, oh, I wish I could be like St. Mary of Egypt. And he says, you know, well, you're not venerating St. Mary of Egypt. And I'm like, wait a minute. He says, you're not supposed to compare yourself with St. Mary of Egypt. And he says, you're not supposed to compare yourself with any saints. And I was like, pump the brakes, because this is everything I've been learning. This is our icons. This is, you know, all the Synaxarium, all of this that we're venerating these saints. And he asked me a poignant question. He said, are we venerating the saints, or are we venerating Christ in that saint? That was my biggest aha moments when it comes to iconography. Because when I look at any of the saints, when I look at St. Mary, or if I look at St. Mary of Egypt, or if I look at any of our icons, it's because I see Christ in them, and I understood more what that means, that it is a window. And then the other thing, oddly enough, came from a book called Heaven is for Real. Have any of you read that or heard about it or saw the movie where the little boy who was, what, about 3 years old died on the operating table and then came back with these experiences of Christ? What impacted me most about him was he was a three-year-old boy who had no skin in the fight. And he was talking about meeting his grandpa and seeing Jesus. And I don't want to give it away if you ever want to read it. It's a great book. But here it's written by the son of a Protestant pastor. So again, he has no skin in the fight. But the things he was saying was showing me, now I'm talking about intercession of the saints, but it's almost intrinsically attached to the iconography. It just showed me that there really is no such thing as death in the way that we see it. Ergo, Jesus saying, Lazarus is sleeping, so let's go. And well, if he's sleeping, he'll get better. Okay, Lazarus is dead. Like, let me say it in your language. Yet, when we talk about repose, we talk about asleep in Christ. So dead is dead in your trespasses, dead in your sins. That's what dead is. And these saints aren't dead. They're very much alive. Just because my daughter right now is in Baldwin Park and I'm here in Chino, I don't speak of her as though she's gone. She's just in Baldwin Park. So the same thing with these saints, just because they're in another location, that this is our window. This is how we see Christ through them and in them. This is how we worship Christ, and this is a remembrance of their struggle, and this is to know that they struggled like we struggled, and to ask them for their help. That was a really long answer, and I'm sorry that it kind of meshed the two together, but I don't know how to separate them.
At the core, in my mind, having gone through this, is a very, very substantial difference in how one understands the incarnation. And people were telling me this, you don't get the incarnation. So the issues of the icons, intercessions of the saints, virtually every Western Christian that you're going to encounter is going to have the exact same problems. It's kind of new and different to most of the Copts, because you don't tend to have too many converts. And when you do, they typically married in and really didn't put a hard theological testing to the church. So generally that's how it happens. So you don't really understand the differences in the theology, but in some ways the Western mind in the evangelical community is very close to the Gnostic mind of the early centuries in taking this spiritual perfect reality, which is separate from this fallen physical reality, and separating the two. Therefore, no, icons are part of the physical reality. The saints, the intercessions of the saints, they're not part of this reality, they're in the other reality, and there's this bifurcation. Well, when you understand, finally, as a potential convert, that the whole point of the incarnation was to join the two, because they were separated. That's what they're reading about throughout Scripture. They were separated. They were divided when we cut ourselves off from God in the garden. But the whole point of the incarnation and of salvation was to bring the two, bring divinity back in, bring spiritual back into the physical and complete them. Now, one thing that really helped us, that if you have inquirers, I thought was very useful for both of us, was there were a few things that, of course, I was stuck on. The icons, the ever-virginity of St. Mary, the intercessions of the saints. And I said, I asked Abuna Daniel, if I don't come on board with those, can I still be Orthodox? And he said, yes. You don't. These are not mandatory. These are not core. But you can't oppose the church in them. You can't start going around the church and trying to battle against the church in these areas or draw other people away. But if you privately are not comfortable with, you know, kissing an icon or asking a saint to pray for you, that's okay. And it not only told me that I can be Orthodox even if I didn't come on board, but it also told me that the core was correct because it had Christ at the core, that the core dogma that was, these are non-negotiables, were the right things. They were the early and universal things that I had found historically. Because I don't know if you're aware, but iconography kind of took some time to develop, and the idea of the intercessions of the saints took some time to develop. But the things which were early and universal, immediate, the things our historical research was pointing to as these were the core, they were exactly the same core in the Orthodox Church. They got it. They had it right.
Sorry if this is redundant. I wasn't here last week. But, you know, a lot of us were born into the church, and this is how we were, you know, grew up with these understandings and learnings. What is it that attracted you to this specific church versus a different church? I mean, was there a specific item?
Yeah, okay. So last week's talk was, how did we become Orthodox? Because the question was, what is authentic Christianity? And it came down to orthodoxy. This is the correct expression of the Christianity the apostles handed down. This is the church, the Orthodox Church. Now, being Americans, we knew we had the option. We had Antiochian churches that were full of Americans. Yeah, and we visited, and they would be, we would be culturally at home there. There were the Russian churches who had brilliant theologians and scholars. I mean, if you even try and read Lossky, you have a hard time, but Florovsky is very lofty, but really, really good stuff. You have the Greek churches, which their food is about as good as yours. I hate to admit it, but it is. So being Americans, we had our choice of any flavor, and we could still be in the church. But there was something we saw in the Coptic church, and it was this. What was the context of that early church that we read about? They were a small persecuted minority religious group. That was who you're reading about in the New Testament. Well, you guys have been that for 2,000 years. It really hasn't changed. There may be harder times of persecution and easier ones, but the spirit of that early church that you read about, that we had been reading about in the New Testament in Scripture, that spirit was here, and it was an intangible. I couldn't, you know, give you letter by letter, this is it. But the spirit that we sensed when we read was the same one that was here. very uniquely here. There are great American parishes, and this isn't for everybody, the Coptic Church, absolutely. I mean, it is very cultural, we know, and it might take years to get through that cultural barrier. But there is something, and I was trying to figure out for a long time, how can I tell somebody what this is? How can I define it for somebody? And really, all what I kind of settled into, it's this. It's the good, the bad, what you give us, what you don't give us. And it's the midweek liturgy with the elder Copts that are coming in, and their heads are down, and they carry this posture. They're not the people who will jump for joy at a good thing or scream and mourn at a bad thing. It all comes from the hand of God, and it's this posture of submission, which is to recognize everything is in God's hand and out of your power. Now, honestly, I think the Muslims have helped to teach you that and helped to maintain it, because it is out of your power. And you've been kept in this place for centuries and centuries where you didn't have power, and you really, it's in God's hands. There's nothing you can do. But it maintained that early church spirit. So that was the first thing. The second was your clergy. Because it was a church of persecuted sheep for 2,000 years, your clergy, in my opinion, are the greatest in the earth. We could go to almost any parish and be right at home, sit under that priest and do what he says. They are the best spiritual guides, the best shepherds we have ever seen. And so that was why, and you know, the thing is, like, I can read books from Russian Orthodox scholars, and I do. And the Antiochian churches have great resources for a Westerner to learn about Orthodoxy. So all these things that I can access from all the Orthodox churches are mine. But the individual guidance of a priest, I want it to be a Coptic priest. And the community of faith, of a simple, submissive, truly humble faith before God, it kind of stood out uniquely within the Coptic Church. And so I embraced it. And it wasn't, you know, it's one of those things that you absorb. You know, it, honestly, 3 solid years before, you know, the older stone-faced Egyptian women that have that hard look, 3 solid years before all of a sudden they started smiling at me. I mean, I have never seen that woman smile ever at anybody, and they all started smiling, and they all started, the older men were starting to welcome us. And it took a few years, and I'll tell you, that meant more than all the greeters at every Protestant church we'd ever attended, because it said, you're one of us now. We welcome you. And we understand it takes a long time, and we appreciate the skepticism and that, you know, I'm not sure about you. And I'm sure reports kind of came filtering back little by little that, no, they're actually very zealous for this church. And so it meant so much. But if they never had embraced us, it really wouldn't matter, because I'm absorbing from them. I'm receiving from them without them saying a word, just being in the liturgy with them.
I just want to know, what did you mean by the Muslim helped us? You mean through persecution or what? Yeah. Okay.
So I've had a long-standing debate with an atheist colleague of mine who I'd like to kind of get your thoughts on as an apologetist. So I'm sure you may be aware of Bart Ehrman and his work and how he's basically suggesting that the authenticity of the Bible can never be what we claim it to be, that the manuscripts were, that were written, you know, at the time of the apostles are nowhere near the manuscripts that we are the gospels that we have today, through inherent human error and the transcribers and, you know, transcribers can actually add in or take out writings, and that the Bible that we have today is in no shape, way, or form the manuscripts that were written back in during the time of the apostles. So how do you reconcile that? They're providing, you know, case after case of various, you know, case, you know, specifics. And I just find myself you know, having a very difficult time to argue that, you know, when they provide that level of historical rigor.
Oh. No, that's okay. You're fine. I'm going to hand this off to Tilo because he'll best be able to handle that. But your question is really important. I just want to make sure that everybody grasps it. Bart Ehrman is not the only one. There are a lot of people that question the historicity of Jesus, that he, first of all, even existed as a human being. They will late date scriptures. They'll say that they were written much, much later. They'll say that the disciples, not even Jesus existed, but the disciples didn't exist, and that Paul is kind of a compilation made up. He's a character to represent a bunch of ideas, so he wasn't an actual historical person either. So this is kind of along the lines that we're going, and because if we're going to talk to people about Christ, the first place we're going to go is the scriptures, right? Well, if that's completely undermined and cut out and unreliable, then his question is a very, very important one. We have to stand there first and say, what I'm sharing with you, is it even reliable? Tilo's done a lot of study on this.
Well, there is no answer I could give you right now that would be even remotely comprehensive. It's going to take you months of study and research, but there are very good answers. But there are, actually, the question covers a number of topics. So, first of all, C.S. Lewis was really good in pointing out that these New Testament critics, like Ehrman, their scope is so narrow in this religious one book. And C.S. Lewis said, but they're not literary experts. They're not experts in ancient literature. They're just hyper-focused on this one narrow thing. So he was saying they don't have a palate. They can't taste it in its proper context, and they have problems trying to file it into something. So there's one aspect of the question, is you're just viewing this one document narrowly. The second one is, generally what you're going to hear is it's all the focus is on the four Gospels. But there's a lot more than the four Gospels. We have a lot of epistles. And so when Ehrman points out the discrepancies in the manuscripts, okay, so here's the first question is, how can we ascertain historically whether something happened? Well, there are basic tests of historicity. And so if we apply, and this is what I've had this discussion with many atheists, give me the standard by which we can judge if something happened historically. You give me any standard you want, and let's apply it to this, and then I'm going to pick some things. And I did this with one friend, and I said, okay, let's take your standard, and let's go with, I'm going to make it really easy, Alexander the Great. I mean, this is somebody about as big in history as ever. Well, I'm sorry, but the manuscripts you're looking at, the writers were hundreds of years after the event, and the manuscripts are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years after the event, and there's a tiny handful. Whereas with this, you're going way back, right close to the event, many, many manuscripts that you can compare to each other. So it's not just in the discrepancies. Okay, 98% of those are little scribal errors, and really, they're of no consequence. And Ehrman actually admits that. They're of no consequence. So let's take all the ones where there, let's say, you actually have a valid discrepancy. Okay, toss those out. What do we have left? Well, we still have the same thing. And I think one of the best arguments I've heard is from, and this will be a great place to point you, Gary Habermas, Habermas. And he's over at Biola, and he does a minimalist argument for the resurrection of Christ, taking it down to the most fundamental points. And the question is, how can we account for this historical data? Because when the planes flew into the Twin Towers on September 11th, we can be pretty sure there were no Mormons pretending to be Muslims flying those planes, because the authenticity of their belief was that, look what they were willing to do for it. If you're lying, if you're fabricating, if you're pretending, it's going to end long before you're flying a plane into a building. You're going to go, no, I'm just playing along. I'm not really a devout, whatever sect of Muslim it is. So in the same way, the apostles. Now, people will say, okay, but they can't all be right. I agree. But you see, we're saying here in a room, we believe this is true. And we might do something based on that belief. But remember what the apostles' testimony was. It wasn't we believe he's the Christ in and of itself like it is with us. Their testimony was we touched him. We put our fingers in the holes. We saw him for 40 days as he was teaching us and appearing in rooms. Now, if that is either true or not true, and it has to be accounted for somehow. And through the 19th century, there were attempts to answer that in the German Historische Religionsschule, which was like the critical school of religion in the 1800s. And they had these different theories they came up with. Well, he wasn't really dead. It was called the swoon theory. He was just passed out, but then he revived. And then there come the questions of, well, we're having these people worshiping a risen God resurrected from the dead, not somebody who's still pretty much half dead, stumbling out, barely breathing. They're giving you a very different picture here. And that's setting aside the point that you're not going to make it through that ordeal alive. Roman executioners are good at their jobs. So these are just a few of the things that come up. Honestly, you can offer information, but you can usually tell most people really aren't seeking the truth. And that includes within the church, by the way, being open and seeking the truth, being willing to be pliable when you see it going in another direction you didn't like. So, don't ever get in your mind that there's this thing I can offer that this will be the convincing factor. There never will be. The Pharisees saw him, withered hands, Lazarus raised from the dead. I mean, come on. It's if you saw all of that and can say, no, crucify him, well, there's nothing that's going to be that convincing.
So these are skeptics that are just too wise for their own good. I mean, they're so scientifically driven that, show me there's nothing based on
faith. Okay, you know what? What he's saying is that he's wondering if these are just skeptics who are so scientifically driven that it's all just kind of factual information for them. But the truth is no. None of us are purely objective. It's just not possible. We all have what we would prefer to be true. All of us. And we see everything through that lens. All of us. So I don't care how much somebody claims to be entirely objective. If they don't even acknowledge they have a bias and a preference, they're the most biased and unreliable of any, in my opinion. I trust more a guy who says, yeah, I really don't want there to be a judgment. I don't want there to be a God to tell me I can't do the things I enjoy doing. But I'm going to do my best to be open-minded anyway. That's legitimate. Then that guy, I believe, has a much better chance at being objective than somebody who denies the bias in the first place, because he doesn't even see his own bias. If you don't even see it, it's going to be pretty hard for you to get past it. In the question, how do we know what's true? Rome offers a papacy to answer this question. What do we know? How can we be absolutely solid about believing something? And that's why when the papacy is questioned, what about this pope and this mistake, or this one overturned that one? They have to go through these major acrobatics to come up with some kind of answer. Because if the pope and the papacy can be shown to be fallible, it's a house of cards and the whole thing crumbles. Well, Ehrman's challenge is based upon a different house of cards, which is the Protestant one, which is sola scriptura. Because if there can be shown to be errors in the scripture, the whole thing, this is how we know it's true, the whole house of cards crumbles. But you can address him by saying, we don't have this house of cards. you can say these things are wrong in the scripture, and I'll say, okay, let's say those are errors, and the truth is somewhere between them. Okay, well, we still have the rest of the tradition, the rest of the history, the rest of the existence of all of these churches believing the same thing in a community and a world where people don't play fast and loose with religion. They riot over changing a word. So it kind of shows that, no, you can take any piece and challenge one of our church fathers, and you can challenge this piece of scripture, and you can even challenge that piece of history. It doesn't change anything, because all of it together is our foundation. And you can go chip away a couple little pieces out of the concrete here, there, and there, and this foundation is just as solid as it ever was. Whereas the problem, and what Ehrman is addressing, and actually what all the atheist arguments are addressing, are Western Protestant Christian ideas, not our ideas generally. So that might be a help, is to show actually we don't fall under that, so your challenge really doesn't apply to us as much.
Is there anything from the Protestant church that you say, oh, I wish the Coptic church did? Or is there any, like, some of the marketing, or maybe there's bits and pieces that you're like, well, if the Coptic church did this, it would really help? I'm just curious.
I'll go first, because I think I spent a lot more time in the Protestant church than Tilo did. I'm 48 years old, and I was in the Protestant church from the time I was 5 until I was, 43 then, right? Because we've been 42, 43. So a lot of years. And I give me a second to think, because I want to give you an honest answer. I really... What's that?
Anything about Sunday school, too. Is there any practices that we could bring?
You know what? I can't say that there's anything that I, like, I really can't say that there's anything that there's any sort of nuance even that I wish that we would import. Now, there are things that I could see that could be fine-tuned and tweaked a little bit. But it's not from the Protestant churches we attended. Because even when I started coming, when you talk about Sunday school, when I started coming to the Orthodox church and I saw all these kids and I saw moms trying to wrangle their kids, I felt really bad that, like, the moms should be alleviated of this, so they can enjoy the liturgy, and the kids should be off someplace else. And but then I did that in ignorance, because I had a priest tell me, well, this is the coming together. This is where the body and the blood of Christ is. And we do this once, and we do this for everyone. And why should children, you know, when children are the ones that Jesus said, let the little children come unto me. I mean, like, he specifically mentioned the children. Why should we deny them the most important part of this? And there's so much that's gleaned from the kids and from the adults. On the flip side of that, I had Bunabashoy Brownfield. I heard him lay into the congregation one time because kids were running around and everybody was like, and then ladies were turning around and giving dirty looks and, you know, the usual. And he said, they're children and they're doing what children do. And he says, you're an adult. If anybody has a problem here, it's you. Because you should know how to focus, and you should know how to pay attention, and you should know how to get past children being children. So pay attention to the liturgy. It's like, boom, okay.
Well, see, I in the question itself, here's why I would divide up some things. There's that which was handed down, meaning the teachings, the practices, the totality of it all. And then there's that which we actually do. And those aren't necessarily the same. We found it rather astonishing that, I don't know if you know the history of the Protestant schisms, but essentially you had Rome, and I will offer this criticism as something I see frequently within the Coptic Church. The people didn't live Christ from Sunday afternoon till the next Sunday morning, but they relied on the sacraments and participation in them. That's what's going to save me. Well, the Jews had the same thing. Do you remember? Well, we obey the law. Well, or Okay, so we participate in the rituals, or we have Abraham as our father, meaning we were born into it. Well, I see this sometimes in the Coptic Church, the exact same thing. I'm born into it, I'm partaking of the sacraments. And Jesus told both of them, you're in a lot of danger and you don't even know it. Because if you're not personally involved in this, if your heart is not personally given, you're not in me. You're cutting yourself off. So in the same way, you have now the Reformation. And they say, okay, it's not in the things you do. It's not in these physical things. It's in your heart and belief. Now, they jump all the way over here. And so now you have all these new churches based upon these different doctrines about believing. Then, sometime later, John Wesley says, no, it's, you know what, it's not about believing the right thing. You have to be living this faith out in love for your fellow man, and so the Methodists and the Wesleyans, okay? So every time somebody had this realization, something is missing, now a new schism happens that hyper-emphasizes on the new thing. So we found that there's not one thing that any of those schisms were founded upon that doesn't already exist in the history of the Orthodox Church. It's all here. Now, whether it's being actively lived out and portrayed and utilized is another question, but it's there. And I've believed for a long time that when you see something missing in the church, like, oh, they're not welcoming to people. This is Moon's one of my favorite pet peeves. The Coptic people who say, they're not welcoming and loving people, and I'm leaving the church. Like, wait a minute. There's one person in that whole church that truly has Christ in their heart, which is you, and you're seeing that nobody else has Christ in their heart, and you're taking Christ out by leaving? Like, if it bothers you, maybe that's Christ telling you, you should be the one welcoming them. You should be the one loving them. You should be the one doing this. So if you see something that you think is being neglected, it's probably the Spirit tugging at your heart. This is your role. This is your place in the church to go fill that void. So all the things that are there that are of value are here in our history. It's just a matter of bringing them up and doing them and using them.
I keep going back to this. You ended last time with the concept of the importance of having the right posture, and we really spoke about it today several times. So the question is, yes, a lot of us may be in danger of depending too much on the Sunday service or the liturgy or the sacraments and forgetting about the relationship and having the proper posture, like you were saying, with humility and obedience and submission and trying to find God in all of this. So what can we do, either if we're suffering from this, like to improve our posture, or to encourage others to improve their posture so that we have the right faith and also the right practice fused in into one?
You know, it's really funny that when I was first here, and even before this, when I was a Protestant, I used to say, going to church on every week, to me, was a non-negotiable. Because if I found myself drifting, just coming back to church would kind of prick my conscience, and it would hurt, you know? And if you stay away longer, that pain goes away. And that was just going to church once a week. Well, here I learned some things. Like, one of the first things I learned was the Agbeya and praying it daily. When people tell me, oh, I'm having trouble in my spiritual walk, I'm not, you know, encountering God, I always say, let's start with the basics. Do you pray the Agbeya daily? No, I don't. Okay, do you read scripture frequently? No, I don't. Well, are you reading the Fathers? No, I don't. Well, okay, so you're saying I'm starving, but I never eat any food. Okay, well, maybe you start by eating some food. And the church, again, where I was talking about them having the core things right, they do. Because really the central focal point, I think, of a Copt would be the liturgy and the Agbeya. I mean, this is the one that's daily, and then this is the one that's as frequently as you can. I think if you get those two down to being non-negotiables daily, yeah, and confession. When I say liturgy, I'm talking about all the things that we do here as a group. I'm kind of using a broad brush, but yes, confession, part of that. All the things the church gives us. So if you look at the core elements of daily and weekly Coptic life, if you're really doing it, then those are the first things that, to me, it keeps putting you in front of God. And all these other things are kind of a result of the experience of God. But these are the things that keep putting you there, that you try and, you know, I mean, come on, am I the only one here that when you sin, the last thing you want to do is pray? The last thing you want to do is look at God? Well, this keeps sticking you back in front of him. And it hurts. And it's supposed to hurt. It's, you know, people always, when they say, you know, I don't experience God, and they go, well, what's going on? And it's all this suffering and negative, and I feel really, you know, horrible. Well, what makes you think that's not God? Why do you have this concept that God means rainbows and butterflies? I mean, if God really wants you pure and holy, hearing from God can be really painful, and it can be stuff you don't want to hear. We don't want to hear. It can hurt, and very often does. So we can't exclude this as part of the experience of God. But then again, here we come back to this. What I get, what I don't get. The good, the bad. The joy and the peace, and the conviction and the suffering. We accept it all as from the hand of God. So I always say just start with the core and the basics, and doing those daily. Then you can move on to other things. Once you do those, if you feel like you're not advancing, there is no secret formula, a checklist, but there is, again, an abuna. So what I do is when I hit a wall, I go to my abuna. And I say, I'm trying, I'm struggling, I'm hitting this wall. And then he will give me something. Now I'm going to start doing that. There was a time a while back when I was seeking my abuna and I was hitting walls, and I decided to go see a therapist for a while because there were some psychological problems that were blocking me. But again, going back to the posture question, if you say, I'm not giving up, whether it's going because I have a mental block that's doing something, I need to discuss this, I need to work through this, whether there's, I'm not obeying what the abuna is telling me, whatever the case, if you just, it's the woman with the issue of blood. And we say, well, I tried this three times one time, and it didn't work, so I gave up. I mean, here she's crawling through these streets, half dead, could be stoned to death for being unclean in the city, but she's not giving up. So I think, again, it's not in just the doing, it's in the posture. What the Orthodox Church gives us is somewhere a system of this enormous array of things to which you can apply that posture, to which you can apply that diligence. Say, I want to seek God. What should I do, Abuna? He's got a chest there of about 10,000 things that he can hand you out of that chest, and you're not going to run out. And so when you want to apply something, I'm hitting a wall, I want to go forward. Abuna, what do I do? He'll never run out of things to hand you to go do. And so you might have the posture, I want to move forward. Well, you need to know, what can I do? What can I apply this will towards to move me in that direction? And that's what Abuna is there for. But before I go to Abuna and tell them, well, I've really tried, I need to at least start with the basics. Am I attending the liturgies? Am I going to confession? Am I praying the Agbeya? Am I doing all the staples? Now, okay, but I still feel like I'm not going forward. Then I go to Abuna and say, help me.
Are we pretty much ready to? Oh, you have it? Okay. I'm going to answer that, and then I think Mira will be the last question so that we stay. Okay.
And we can hang afterwards.
Yeah, if anybody wants to, I just want to make sure that people have, you know, if they have things that they have to attend to. Abuna, I would say for myself that the most important thing when you talk about posture and as far as imparting things to anyone else, I don't know. I'm such a hot mess that I don't know how to help somebody else. But as far as myself, it always comes down to humility You know, when I read the sayings of the Desert Fathers, and then also when I talk to my Buna and I hear about like one priest saying for, you know, a whole day or a whole week, just what, if anyone tells you to do something, say yes. And it's like, even if it's a little child, say yes. And then there's another story of, in the sayings of the Desert Fathers, where one of the monks walks up and all of his stuff, there's somebody in his cave stealing his stuff. And so he goes and he helps him. And he's like, oh, you forgot this. And like helps him and he sends him off on his way. And we all have those opportunities. You know, we might not walk up on our house and somebody's stealing it and we help them clean out our house, but we all have this opportunity, say, at work, when somebody, you know, one of our coworkers comes up with a grand idea and it was yours, and you just sit there and you go, that's fabulous. I wish I would have thought of that. But, you know, and you just let them have it. You be humble. Or when I do go to my abuna, when I'm stuck, I have to go to him with a posture of, I'm not asking him for a suggestion. I have to go to him and say, I'm going to do what he tells me to do. And that was another one of the sayings of the Desert Fathers, where a group of pilgrims came and, you know, through everything to get to this monk. And then they came for a word. And he says, I'm not going to give you a word, because you came to get a word to discuss, not to do. So I'm not going to give you a word. And I'm sorry, but that is me, because I'm in the world of apologetics. So I'm kind of in that, and I'm like, let's pick it apart, and I can challenge everything. And so humility is just, it's the biggest thing for me. So, Mira.
Before you were, you became Orthodox and you're like your Protestant self, I've noticed that there's like a fear of Catholicism. And like, as we Orthodox who, as Mike said, like smell Catholic, look Catholic, what could we have done to alleviate your fears and maybe actually bring you maybe to love the Catholic Church too? What could we have done at that time?
Great question. There are some things that, like Tilo pointed out, that if it's too big to unpack right now, that then you say, you know what? For now, there's a lot of other things, so let's talk about those other things and not ignoring whatever your big problem is with intercession of the saints or, you know, praying to Saint Mary or, you know, any of these things like that. It's like, how about this? We're going to put this in a box right now, and we're going to put this on the shelf, and we'll come back to it. But this is a really big one, and the more you learn about the church and the more you learn about the little things, you'll understand this one more, and we can come back to it. I thought that was one of the wisest things, because there were so many fish to fry when I was coming into Orthodoxy, that to say, okay, put this one aside. There was a lot of stuff to look at. And he was right. The more I learned about the church, the bigger stuff did start to make sense. But I think that just asking a lot of questions, or letting them ask you questions. So if they're already open, like Mike, I'm sorry to keep picking on you, but one of the things I loved about him was his humility, and he asked so many questions, and he could seem like he was pushing in hard, but this was just like us. If you heard our testimony, this was going to cost Mike everything. And this was, you know, putting a dividing line between him and people he loved dearly. So was he pushing back hard on Tilo and I and Mira when he was asking questions? Yes. But that's because, remember, there's a huge price tag on it. So be available for those questions. Listen to those questions. And then ask questions yourself. And the biggest thing for that is we got to know the answers to it. So when somebody asks you, why do you pray to dead people even though the Bible says not to? What is your answer for that? Well, why do you put a human being between you and God when Jesus did everything on the cross? That's not a preferential thing. That's a huge dividing line thing. That's like an abomination, or it's something handed down and given to us by God. But what is the answer? So be willing to listen to their questions, and if you need to, say, you know what, I don't know. That's a good question. Go ask an abuna, and then come back and have coffee with the person, spend time and be willing to deal with these and have compassion. Like I said, if it's somebody that's serious, they're going to push back hard on you because it has such a big price tag. And that's the biggest thing that I want to emphasize, is have compassion on what this is going to cost them.
So I think it's also important to understand that if somebody comes in who's really diligently seeking the truth in God, okay, as opposed to, oh, I'm dating an Egyptian and I want to go through this process because I can't get married, because I can't get married to you unless you get dunked by our church. So the person's going to come in, okay, I'm going to see if this is tolerable enough that it can pass the test, that I can just, okay, dunk me so I can marry this beautiful Egyptian girl I love. Well, for that person, I got nothing. I'm sorry. I'm not your guy. Don't even ask me. But for the one who's seriously inquiring, he's going to be pretty astute theologically, and he's going to be a Romophobe, which is what we were, which is what all of us are. And we all have that issue. One big problem I see, though, is that sometimes I hear people in the Coptic Church wanting to copy things from the evangelical church to make them feel more welcome. Well, these issues that we're talking about, the icons, the intercessions and stuff, those you're going to have because you are a Romophobe. You were taught how evil Rome was, and these things were connected with Rome. But those other things, I can promise you, because I've talked to, I can't count how many Orthodox converts, mostly in the Antiochian church, those things you're trying to copy, they were running away from them in the first place. They didn't like them. They didn't like the market-driven research. They didn't like the happy, clappy, fun time with a 30-minute pep talk. They were hungry for something that was solemn, that was deep and substantial, that had roots, that connected them back to the church of history. All these things that you are by nature are the things that were the positive things that we were hungering for, that virtually every single convert will tell you. I walked in and the incense and the solemnity, the priest, the altar, all these things, they were the appealing things. And those are the things people want to kind of, well, no, let's bring in more of this user-friendly thing. They were tired of that world. They didn't want that anymore. I used to come in when we'd talk sometimes, and they'd be singing songs, Protestant songs, in the meetings. And I just got to the point where I said, I'm going to be outside. You come get me when you're done. I don't want any part of this. Because I left the world with a professional band, professionals, with a professional singer, with smoke machines and light shows, and I mean, hundreds of thousands of dollars in production costs. I didn't come here for some cheesy imitation of the thing I left. I came here because I wanted something substantial and real that wasn't entertainment. And that's what you'll find most of the true seekers that walk in the door are looking for, is something of depth. And you know, maybe they're not going to feel welcome. You say, if you have any questions, we can go in the back and I can quietly explain. Or if you'd prefer to just watch, that's your call. But right now, all the attention is forward, so, and that's it. We've come to appreciate that. We don't feel comfortable. If the liturgy is going on and we see somebody we know and they do this, okay, I'm fine with that. I'm not comfortable with you shaking my hand or greeting me. This is not me right now. This is God. And this is the thing that we're seeking, that the inquirers are seeking. So don't try and copy the ex-wife when the guy's looking for a divorce and looking to for somebody who's different.
Abuna, I'll hand this off to you. First of all, thank you so much for your time and for welcoming us. And also, I would encourage you to read. If you don't know what to read, ask Abuna. Like, if you don't know where to start, you know, just read anything, because you'll find out, no matter what it is you read, I don't care what it is you read, somehow God orchestrates these divine appointments where whatever it is that you were just reading, you'll end up in a conversation with somebody about that, that they'll have just that exact question. So it doesn't matter if it's church history or if it's theology or if it's the, you know, sayings of the Desert Fathers, like anything, God will orchestrate that. But just read. And because Tilo and I, sometimes we come and we say, you need to be sharing your faith. And then we hear stories back about something that a cop said, and we say, stop sharing your faith. Like, I had a friend at work that she knows I'm an open door. She comes to me with all of her questions about the Orthodoxy, and she happens to go to a Protestant church that's down the street from St. John. So a lot of cops end up at her church all the time, so they go to both churches. And she said that one of them was explaining the ever virginity of Mary and how that was possible because Jesus was birthed out of her thigh. And I was just, and she says, is that really true? Is that what the Orthodox believe? And I was just like, oi, back to my Jewish roots. But sometimes it's just like, okay, just stop, read a book, and then share. But anyway, seriously, thank you so much for your time. And mostly thank you so much for welcoming us into the Coptic Church. And don't clap.
Thank you again. I hope everyone had the opportunity to ask their questions. And I think this is encouraging for us to give us a more clear vision, not only for us personally on how to grow and how to teach our children the proper posture and focus on growing in the Orthodox faith, but also the mindset that we need in thinking about people converting to the church and not trying to be like less Orthodox, but rather trying to emphasize the deep Orthodoxy that we have in the church. Thank you again. We'll stand up to pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Finally, Lord, we put ourselves and our church in your hands, and we ask you to continually allow your church to grow and to flourish and not let the gates of Hades prevail against it. Be with us always and fill us with your fear and your love. Through intercession of the Holy Mother of God, St. Mary, all the blessings of the saints who have pleased you since Adam to the end of the ages, hear us and have mercy upon us. Make us worthy to pray thankfully. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil one. In Christ Jesus, our Lord, for thine is the kingdom. The love of God, Father, grace, His only begotten Son, our Lord, God, and Savior, Jesus Christ, communion, gift, fellowship, the Holy Spirit, be with you. Depart in peace, and the peace of God.